What do we need to know about taking care of our children's teeth? I know you know the basics. Let them brush twice a day. Use toothpaste. You know the nitty gritty of brushing teeth. But I'm sure there's some more information that we can learn today when it comes to taking care of our children's teeth. And we are joined in this conversation by the magnificent, Harvard educated, Boston trained, Dr. Joyce Gitauni. You know what I've just remembered, by the way?
Yes.
My son's, my eldest son, yes. His first dental experience was actually with you.
Right, yeah.
It's been a couple of years and now he's 11.
He was a toddler then, right?
Yeah. Well, now he's almost a teen.
Exactly.
So I know even for the parents who are watching, they're in good hands.
Yes.
And initially, actually, your place was called Dental Smiles for Kids.
Yes.
Before it became Dental Smiles.
Yes, Dental Smiles Nairobi, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So good to have you.
Thank you.
Good to have you.
Yes,
auntie. Children. Yeah. Children. Mm. If I was a new mother, I wish I knew that I needed to start thinking about taking care of my child's teeth from the time they are. How many months?
I think even when they're born, really, right?
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, what they're taking in and all that.
Yes.
So let's take it from dental, you know, tips from the time you have a small baby.
Right.
What do moms, what do dads need to be doing?
So number one, I think let's start when they're zero. They have no teeth, so we always think that nothing is really happening in there.
Mm-hmm.
But let's take, for example, that, you know, they're using a bottle or they're using a pacifier and it falls down. What do we do as parents? We just pick it up and use, you know, clean it with our mouth. And then give it to them, and what we're doing is spreading germs into their mouth. So number one, you should not clean your children's teethers or the drinking bottle nipples with your own mouth. Take hot water and cleanse it or sterilize it as you normally do. But don't use your own mouth to clean it, because you are spreading whatever germs that you're carrying inside your mouth, you're transferring it to the baby.
You know, you're thinking about for any mom, I know it is tiring, it's a lot of work being a mom. Mm. It's fallen, your pacifier has fallen for the 1,000th time.
Right.
And Dr. Gitangu is saying that you need to wash it and sterilize it again.
Yes.
But I mean, it's better to be safe than to be sorry.
Yes. Or carry just
or
extra.
Or have a few, you know.
Have extra ones.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Exactly.
That's a good point.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then also, you know, when they're young, we have to be very careful about, you know, children sleeping on the breast because it can cause things like nursing caries, because those are things that now kids start picking that habit of they cannot sleep without the breast.
Right.
Or even a bottle if they're not breastfeeding. And that can cause baby bottle caries, which is decay, decay on the teeth caused by bacteria.
Interesting.
Yeah, so usually when they are sleeping with the milk, you know, either the bottle or the breast, the sweetness or the sugar from the milk just pulls around their teeth.
That's true.
Yes, and it has sugar, so eventually it will cause decay. So you start noticing when your kids' first teeth are coming out, erupting into their mouth, they already have decay on them. And some kids are just as young as even maybe 1.5,
and they already have. You've ever seen?
I think it was 13 months, and they already had decay, and it was really tough working on the parent, on the child. But we had to fix those teeth, and even sometimes the decay is so rampant that we can't even save those teeth. So they don't even have those initial teeth to even have regular speech.
Good stuff.
Yeah, good
stuff.
Pitch patterns. Yeah.
That's tough.
So, so that's number one. So we have to stop the habit early of them getting used to sleeping with a breast and using the bottle to sleep.
Yeah.
Okay. Then, of course, we always say that a child should visit the dentist at least when the first set of teeth are coming in, or by their first birthday.
They should have come in. Yes. And seen you, and or a dentist, of
exactly.
Course.
And of course, we get asked, but the child has sometimes maybe one or two teeth in their mouth. But that's a good avenue for us to be able to start discussing about, you know, good oral hygiene habits.
Mm-hmm. Right technique.
Yes, the right technique and such, and things like even the borehole water, if we can, you know, discuss about, you know, those exposures that they're having at that age. The other things is also to address other, you know, parafunctional habits. When I mean parafunctional, I mean things like, you know, using a pacifier for prolonged use. It causes certain malformations of teeth. If you're using a sippy cup for a long, long time also, it can do that. So we discuss some of those things so that by that time, we can be able to manage that before it becomes a problem.
Dr. by what time, if there's a parent who's watching and the baby is using a pacifier, by what age should we be thinking of weaning that child off the pacifier?
I say by 15 months.
15 months,
15 months is a good time to start thinking of other options. But the earlier, the better, because at 15 months, the child is very attached to it. So if we can maybe
wean them before,
it'll be easier. The other thing is using a bottle. I think by the time a child is a 1 year,
we should
they should start using a CP cup, and by two they should be drinking from a regular cup,
not
without
a CP
the CP.
Cup.
Yeah, yes.
I know, can imagine, you know, kids become very attached to the.
Yes,
so the bottles,
and it's very hard. It's very, very hard for both the parent and the child to quit the habits.
That's
if we can just be aware of those things early and just avoid them altogether if we can.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
Good point.
Yes.
Back to the basics. I know, we talk about it all the time, and they're watching and thinking, yeah, fine, we know we need to brush. They need to brush twice a day.
Right.
Back to the point of technique. For children especially, which I guess should apply also to adults, what should be the right technique when you are teaching our children on how to brush their teeth? What should we be telling them?
So children, of course, if you're talking about an infant, you know, when you choose the type of brush, you know, to use, it has to be an infant brush. And usually they have these rubber brushes where you can stick your finger and it can help brush.
I remember those.
Yes, yeah. So you can look for an infant brush. Some of them come as a form of a cloth. But what if you can't get an infant brush? You can use either a towel, the one that you're washing the baby with, and use it to clean the teeth. You know, at least after they have breastfed.
Okay.
And then make sure that they don't sleep, obviously, with a bottle and drink water. If they have to drink something, it's they're drinking water before they're breaking the habit of the sleeping with a bottle.
Okay.
So that when you brush your teeth, you're not giving the milk back again, and then, you know, it just really beats the purpose.
It does.
Yeah,
it does,
then there is toddler toothbrushes and, of course, children toothbrushes. So there are toothbrushes designed
for children.
Because of the size of the brush, the, you know, the bristles have to be extra soft, so they're not really
soft
abrasive.
Bristles. Okay.
Yes, and then of course when they're older, we want to make their brushing more exciting.
How do we do that?
We can buy them like battery operated toothbrushes.
That is so
you
cool.
know. Yes, or brushes with timers, you know, so that they can be engaged as they brush for that 2 minutes, because for them the attention is so low, so it's very hard for us to stay. Yes. Then we have to supervise their brushing. We can't just tell a 3-year-old, here's your toothbrush, go brush. We have to supervise. So we can let them brush, enjoy doing the brushing, but we have to go and reinforce whatever has been done.
What should we be reinforcing at that time of supervision? What are the things as parents we should be doing?
So we want to usually make sure we are using the proper technique that we have spoken about. So it's the round, brushing round
not
and round and round, and not, yes, not those vertical or horizontal lashes.
And
yeah.
You say the 30 seconds upper?
Yes.
Then
30 seconds. Right, yes. Whichever order.
And the tongue.
And the tongue. We cannot forget the tongue.
Should we be buying tongue brushes or something?
You can buy a tongue brush. I mean, they're there. You know, if you can't find it, you can just use your normal toothbrush. But most importantly, you should change your toothbrush after every 3 months. Every 3 months. And even when you get sick, so let's say you have a strep throat, or you've just come, you've gotten over this bad flu, you should definitely change that toothbrush, because it carries some of that, the germs that...
Do you know how a good point that is? Because our kids persistently have these colds.
Right, exactly.
And throat infections.
Right.
And possibly they could be coming back through the toothbrush.
Exactly, yeah, you know. And of course, with now the wave of new diseases, we don't know how long they are staying in certain surfaces. So, yeah, so it's important to figure out those things. I think flossing, you know, we say they should start flossing when the contacts in between their teeth start to close.
And that is from what age?
I think about 3 years old. About 3 years old, yeah. And it should be supervised, because some of the super flossers are small.
Mm.
So we have to make sure that we are there so that, you know, it doesn't cause a choking hazard.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, then of course, you know, nutrition is important for them, because this is when we start engaging them with healthy habits, which kind of, you know, sets them up for better oral hygiene, mm-hmm. and good general health, obviously. So this is when we don't get them used to eating sweet stuff like the Oreos, you know, the biscuits, the yogurts with the high sugar, the milk with the high, you know, the flavored milks and stuff like that. So we become very conscious about the type of foods we're giving our children, especially if they are prone to have high. Yeah, and it's very easy. You can look at the nutritional facts of the food that you're giving your children, because you'll be very amazed how much sugar is in some of the things you didn't even know had sugar.
Like yogurt.
Yes.
Something I've never thought about.
Exactly, yes. And then of course, like the things for, you know, maybe sweetening their stuff with honey. I know a lot of parents do that. First of all, honey should not be used with kids under 2 years old because of botulism.
I thought it was one, so it's under two.
It's under two, yeah, yeah. So you just want to start introducing it a little later, but still it has sugar, so I wouldn't really
advocate
for that.
What's the danger of sugar for your under 2 year old? Sugar, honey sugar, to your under 2 year old?
It's still natural sugar, so it'll still cause decay.
Ah,
it'll still cause decay, right. If it's, you know, if it's overused. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
As we're wrapping up this conversation, it's amazing how time flies.
Right. Right.
When it comes to children and, you know, their oral hygiene, what are some of the other things we could be thinking about? Maybe they could be affecting them and we don't know. I want to focus on a few. For example, thumb sucking. How does it affect their teeth, and what advice can you give us?
Yeah, so thumb sucking, also sucking your tongue. Most people never think it's a bad habit, but sucking your tongue and, you know, thumb sucking and extended use of pacifiers and teethers, and then of course mouth breathers.
What are mouth breathers?
Mouth breathers are, you know, because of whatever issue that they are having. Usually sometimes it's systemic. It means that there's something happening inside.
Internally.
It can be an ENT, an ear, nose, throat situation that's causing it. But also it could just be a skeletal situation that can be corrected later on with braces. However, they breathe through their mouth instead of their nose. So because of breathing through their mouth, you know, their tongue resting position is usually down instead of on the roof of the mouth. And usually when your tongue is on the roof of the mouth, it allows your formation of teeth and alignment to be in the proper position. But when your tongue is down, it causes a malformation, so your teeth are not like closing, or you end up having other, you know, dental, you know, misalignments.
Speaking of misalignment, what are the solutions you can propose to us as parents?
Misalignment, usually if it's just a dental misalignment, you know, we look at things as like braces, and sometimes we have to wait for them until they're about 10-11 when all their baby teeth are out. However, before then we want to stop the habit, because if you are still sucking your thumb, you cannot get braces. Or if you're using if you're still a mouth breather and we haven't addressed the problem, you will still have that malformation even after. So we try and stop the habit. Then after that, we do discuss braces when they're obviously older. But if they're young and you see a child already starting to have malformations, they can be corrected by other appliances. They usually will still need braces, but it helps the prognosis of the braces in terms of it improving the outcome of braces. So there are things that we can do before that. The compliance is not really good at young age, but whatever small we can do to improve the situation, the better. Yeah.
Finally, to a parent who's watching and they're thinking, I have struggled to get my child to stop sucking their thumb, what's the one sure way or the one thing they can tell their kids, and this thing is done once and for all? Is there any sure way?
I don't think so. I mean, parents really, they really struggle with that, and people have tried put like bitter stuff.
Doesn't work.
Yes, negative reinforcement, positive reinforcement, you know. I've seen positive reinforcement working, where you tell your child, for example, I'll buy you this, or I'll get you this if you stop sucking your thumb. You know, so it's kind of motivation for them to get something.
But do you know, it's such a reflex. I can imagine when you're sleeping at
night.
Just coming.
Eventually, most kids, they will stop, especially when they start school, they will stop. Usually most of the time when they're young, they're just doing it, they're soothing, you know, they are going through a lot of discoveries, you know, they're exploring this world and it's too much for them, and they just look for something to soothe them. So they, you know, once they adjust to this new world, then they're able to stop and maybe pick another habit, like we say, the tongue thrusting and, you know, possibly mouth breathing and stuff like that.
Thank you so much for, you know, sharing all this information. And I believe as parents, we need to be the ones who are mirroring this good behavior for our kids.
Exactly.
Not only brushing our teeth once
and
a day,
important.
But then, of course, twice a day.
Yeah.
Starting from us mirroring those good behaviors, and then...
Yes,
it will trickle down 100%, to our children.
Kids do what we do, not what we say.
Absolutely. In a sentence, your final parting shot.
Of course, you know, dental health is something that, you know, is not obviously discussed, you know, as a public health concern. Obviously, people are dying of other bigger diseases, so it just seems like it's something under the rug. But I just want to stress the importance of oral health and its connection to your general health. It does implicate every aspect of your life, and I've seen it cripple people. So if it's something that you want to start early, I encourage you, just start somewhere, look up a dentist around your area, and start the journey of taking care. Invest in your teeth and be proud of your mouth.
Awesome. Right. Thank you, Dr. Gitang. And like, just to emphasize another thing you've said, we need to start early, and as soon as your child turns one, make sure you take them for their first dental visit. Yes. Thank you so much for joining in the conversation. If there's anything you'd want us to cover in future when it comes to dental, you know, dental concerns, we'd be happy to look at them. Make sure you go down to the comment section and leave us with your feedback. See you in the next video.